Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Stalingrad by David M. Glantz and Jonathan M. House. Narrated by Paul Woodson. Preface and Acknowledgements. In 1998, we set out to replicate our study of the struggle at Kursk in 1943, attempting to write a one-volume history of the 1942-43 campaign that culminated at Stalingrad. As in our previous collaborations, we also hoped to bring balance to Western perceptions of this campaign, comparing German and Soviet accounts to approach a more objective understanding of what occurred and why. Almost from the first, however, we discovered significant contradictions within and between sources. They often disagreed, not only on interpretations, but also on the very facts at issue, such as which units fought at what locations on what dates. Rather than a triumphal German army falling into a trap laid by hordes of Soviet opponents, we found an ongoing struggle between two nearly equal adversaries, neither of which could mass sufficient combat power to achieve a decisive victory. Some units appeared to be in two places simultaneously, while other units went unreported. The reason for many of these discrepancies gradually emerged. The best-known memoirs of Stalingrad, such as Field Marshal Erich von Manstein's Lost Victories and Marshal of the Soviet Union Vasily Ivanovich Chuikov's The Battle for Stalingrad, had been written from memory, without access to the primary records of the struggle. Official historians, most notably Earl Ziemke and Magna Bauer of the U.S. Army Center of Military History, had incorporated many captured German records, but other such documents were believed lost in the war, and the Soviet archives and detailed after-action reports were largely unavailable until the 1990s. Even now, there are undoubtedly some records of the campaign that have yet to come to light. The focus of the original project therefore changed. David Glantz undertook the arduous task of assembling and translating the available Soviet records, as well as numerous studies by Russian historians. Recent Western histories, most notably the multi-volume German official history, Germany in the Second World War, complemented these Soviet accounts, as did numerous analyses by gifted Western historians such as Jason Mark, Joel Hayward, von Hardesty, and Ilya Grinberg. There is also a new generation of post-Soviet Russian historian archivists, especially Alexei Isayev and V.A. Zolotaryov, as well as recently published, unexpurgated versions of participants' memoirs. We attempted to merge all these interpretations and documents into the ambitious Stalingrad Trilogy that, with supplemental documents, appeared in five volumes between 2009 and 2014. This present volume returns to the original project, with John House using David's groundbreaking research to write a balanced history of Stalingrad in an accessible one-volume format. Of necessity, this version omits some of the detail of the original series of books. Except during the street fighting in Stalingrad, this account is told primarily at the operational rather than the tactical level. Nonetheless, we believe that the result gives listeners a comprehensive account of how and why one of the pivotal campaigns of World War II played out as it did. The enormous sacrifice of participants on both sides deserves to be not only remembered, but also understood. And we hope this study will find a different, larger audience than the multi-volume trilogy. David M. Glantz, Colonel Field Artillery, retired, Carlisle, Pennsylvania. Jonathan M. House, Colonel, Military Intelligence, retired, Leavenworth, Kansas. Prologue. The German army was poised to launch Operation Blau, Blue, its second summer offensive to conquer the Soviet Union. After great efforts, the Germans had replaced most but not all the equipment and personal losses of 1941, at least in Army Group South, which would conduct the main attack southeastward to the Caucasus Mountains. Then, less than 2 weeks before the scheduled start of the main offensive, and with preliminary attacks already underway, a staff officer compromised a significant portion of the Blau plan. The cause was one of the recurring weaknesses of German operational procedures, the lack of operations security. Auftragstaktik, loosely translated as mission-type orders, allowed subordinate commanders to exercise considerable initiative depending on the situation. To do this, however, commanders and staff officers believed they needed to know the plans of higher and adjacent units, so that a local decision would support the commander's intent. Unfortunately, widespread sharing of such information caused a geometric increase in the probability that the enemy would also learn of German plans. This problem had compromised a number of earlier German operations. On January 10, 1940, for example, a German aircraft inadvertently made a forced landing near Mechelen in neutral Belgium. On this plane was the logistics planner for the Luftwaffe's 7th Parachute Division, carrying significant extracts from the German plan, Case Yellow, to invade the Low Countries. This event forced the Germans to completely rework their campaign plan. Next, during the invasion of Crete, the British found a regimental operations order on the body of a dead officer. Such compromises had prompted Adolf Hitler to demand stringent restrictions on information. For example, no operations order was to be taken forward of Corps headquarters prior to an attack. Unfortunately, many German officers continued to follow their usual habits, violating the spirit, if not the letter, of Hitler's instructions. One such well-intentioned meddler was General of Panzer Troops Georg Stumme, commander of the 40th Motorized Corps. At the urging of his subordinates, Stumme dictated a one-page summary of the first phase of the forthcoming offensive, Blau 1, and distributed that summary, along with a map overlay, to his division commanders. In turn, each division commander shared this information with his own operations officer, known as IA in the German system, grossly circumventing standing security orders. Major Joachim Reichel, the IA of 23rd Panzer Division, compounded the problem by taking the overlay and summary on an aerial reconnaissance of his division's assigned axis of advance. On the afternoon of June 19, 1942, Reichel's Fiesler Stork, a small liaison aircraft identical to the one that had landed in Belgium in 1940, disappeared behind Soviet lines after suffering a fuel leak from ground fire. A German combat patrol found the downed aircraft, and nearby the graves of Reichel and his pilot, but there was no sign of the missing order. An investigation led to General Stumme's relief from command, effective July 9th, which in turn necessitated a reshuffling of panzer commanders in the midst of the Blau campaign. Meanwhile, at Hitler's insistence, a court-martial convicted Stumme, his chief of staff, and the division commander of gross negligence, for which the penalty was death. A number of senior officers appealed on behalf of these three men, so Hitler permitted Stumme to be reassigned to North Africa, where he died in October while serving as acting commander of the Panzer Army during Field Marshal Erwin Rommel's temporary absence. Reichel's escapade occurred too late to change the plans for Operation Blau, so the Germans went ahead with them, despite the potential compromise. Fortunately for the attackers, Joseph Stalin suspected that the captured plan was a deliberate deception. It seemed incredible to him that the Germans would jeopardize their plans in such a foolish manner. The Soviet commanders were, in any event, fixated on defending Moscow rather than the road to the Caucasus. Stalin did, however, hedge his bets. In a series of orders in late June, he directed the transfer of various units to Marshal of the Soviet Union Semyon Konstantinovich Timoshenko's Southwestern Front and Lieutenant General Filip Ivanovich Golikov's Bryansk Front, the apparent targets of the upcoming Blau attack. By the time the 40th Motorized Corps attacked as part of German 6th Army, the Southwestern Front alone had 640 tanks to oppose 6th Army's 360, and the Bryansk Front was even stronger, with 1,600 tanks, compared with 4th Panzer Army's 733. These new Soviet armored units were still inexperienced, but their persistent counterattacks hampered and weakened Blau almost from the first day. Reichel's death was an inauspicious start to Germany's last full-scale offensive, and a further step in the steady decline of Hitler's relations with his generals. Part 1. The Limits of Maneuver Warfare, 1942. Chapter 1. Opposing Forces. Barbarossa. Major Reichel's ill-fated reconnaissance came almost exactly 1 year after Germany had invaded the Soviet Union. Operation Barbarossa not only surprised the Soviet leadership, but also caught the Red Army and Air Force in the midst of multiple transitions. The Soviet armed forces were changing their leadership, equipment, organization, doctrine, mobilization status, and defensive plans, making them incredibly vulnerable to the Axis onslaught. 152 German divisions, including 19 panzer and 15 motorized divisions, thrust rapidly into Soviet territory and created a series of vast encirclements that, by December 1941, had killed, wounded, or captured 4.5 million Red soldiers. The German Air Force, or Luftwaffe, achieved air superiority within the first 2 days, supporting the German advance with both airstrikes and limited aerial resupply of spearhead units. By October, the Germans and their Axis allies, especially Finland and Romania, had captured many of the largest population and industrial centers in European Russia, blockaded Leningrad, and threatened Moscow and Rostov. Yet, for all their advantages and successes at the tactical and operational levels, the Germans failed to achieve strategic victory for a number of reasons. The sheer scale of European Russia, complicated by the shortage of railroads and paved highways, meant that the invaders were unable to deliver a decisive blow to the Soviet state. The German army's logistics planners, led by Major General Eduard Wagner, had predicted these problems with uncanny accuracy in a series of briefings they gave to Colonel General Franz Halder, the chief of the Army General Staff, Oberkommando des Heeres, or OKH, in November 1940. Wagner estimated that the army could carry sufficient fuel to advance to a maximum depth of 500 to 800 kilometers, with enough food and ammunition for a 20-day operation. After that, the army would have to pause several weeks for resupply, and it would be dependent on forced labor to convert the captured Soviet rail network to the narrower German gauge to support a deeper penetration. As Wagner had predicted, for the rest of the year and indeed during the deep operations of 1942 as well, German offensives became intermittent and spasmodic. Each cycle began with the mechanized spearheads pausing to build up supplies and repair vehicles. They then lunged forward, usually succeeding in encircling their foes, but having to pause again to wait for the hard-marching infantry to catch up and seal off the resulting pocket, followed by another wait for resupply. Each time, the Germans not only lost their offensive momentum, but also failed to prevent large portions of the Red Army from escaping the trap. To offset this logistical challenge, Hitler, Halder, and other German leaders had planned to destroy the Red Army as far westward as possible, thus minimizing the size of the force needed to occupy the depths of the Soviet Union. However, this plan failed because of two German intelligence mistakes. First, they believed the communist regime had only a fragile hold on its population, and that the whole structure would collapse after a few defeats. Although there were certainly millions of Soviet citizens, especially ethnic minorities who hated the Moscow government, the Germans' harsh occupation policies discouraged collaboration with the invaders, while Stalin's government proved remarkably resilient in controlling and inspiring its population. Second, the Germans had focused on destroying the active duty Red Army, either ignorant or contemptuous of the huge mobilization capacity represented by a pool of 14 million trained reservists. As quickly as the Germans destroyed enemy units, the Soviets used these reservists to generate new ones, often poorly trained and equipped, but still capable of inflicting casualties, to replace them. As early as July 1941, these Soviet units began to exact significant casualties and impose costly delays on the invaders. In a Darwinian process that took place throughout 1941 and 1942, the surviving Red commanders of these early defeats acquired a growing competence in battle, something that most German leaders ignored. Delay was the one thing the Germans could not tolerate, because their third problem, in addition to underestimating the resilience and strength of their opponents, was the very fragile nature of their own war machine. German industry suffered severe shortages of raw materials, even in 1939, and the growing demand for soldiers left German factories permanently undermanned. Hitler had not anticipated a general war when he invaded Poland in 1939, so his armed forces were only partially equipped for combat. Despite its reputation for mechanized modernity, the majority of the Wehrmacht was still dependent on draft animals to move artillery and supplies. Even the 34 Panzer and motorized divisions included a hodgepodge of German tank designs and captured French and Czech tanks, trucks, and guns. This mixture of designs, for which there was a shortage of spare parts and appropriate repair tools, broke down with alarming frequency, especially on the unpaved mud canals that constituted most Russian roads. The German Panzer III and Panzer IV tanks, as well as the standard German anti-tank guns, were obsolescent. These weapons needed significant improvements to stand up to the better armored and armed T-34 and KV-1 tanks coming off Soviet assembly lines. Even the Luftwaffe, which had priority for production and manpower, was primarily a tactical air force, and it had lost many of its most experienced pilots during the Battle of Britain. Germany never produced the armadas of four-engine, long-range strategic bombers employed by the British and Americans. Moreover, because the Versailles Treaty of 1919 had limited the size of Germany's armed forces during the 1920s, they experienced severe shortages of trained manpower, and especially of experienced mid-level leaders, the sergeants, captains, and majors who actually led combat battalions. To form the final 20 divisions for Barbarossa in 1941, three classes of conscripts, including youths who normally would have been drafted in 1942, completed their individual training in May 1941, only a month before the invasion. Outside of those divisions, no more than 321,000 men on active duty were available as trained replacements. Combat losses in the first 3 months of the war absorbed all these replacements. Thus, by the time it ground to a halt outside of Moscow, the German army was in tatters due to both enemy action and the extreme demands of its environment and overstretched logistics. This allowed the Red Army to achieve a temporary advantage, leading to the counteroffensive that began on December 5, 1941. Hitler instinctively refused to retreat and relieved a number of generals who disagreed with him. By the time the winter battles ended, both combatants were severely depleted in manpower and equipment, and their front lines were hopelessly intertwined. Rebuilding the Wehrmacht. By January 31, 1942, the Germans had suffered 917,985 Army and 18,098 Luftwaffe casualties. Their allies, especially the Romanians, had suffered proportionately even more. The Germans had lost more than 41,000 trucks and at least 207,000 horses, as well as 13,600 guns and mortars and 4,903 aircraft. After the trying winter campaigns, German commanders considered only 8 of their 162 divisions in the east to be fully capable. The 16 Panzer divisions in the east had only 140 functioning tanks among them, equivalent to one full-strength division. In January 1942, General of Infantry Georg Thomas, head of the Office of War Economy and Armaments, convinced Hitler that rebuilding the existing formations had to take precedence over creating new units. Manufacturers melted down church bells and textile manufacturing cylinders to obtain the copper necessary for wiring and ammunition casings. The Germans requisitioned thousands of trucks and almost 300,000 replacement draft animals from Western Europe, although neither vehicles nor horses could withstand the harsh Russian climate. Ruthless officials increased the use of slave labor and controlled the food supply more tightly. Perhaps most significantly, Armaments Minister Fritz Todt died in a plane crash in February and was succeeded by Hitler's architect, Albert Speer. Given the divided nature of German government and industry, it would be simplistic to argue that Speer single-handedly forced through the necessary arms production. However, he did cooperate with numerous officials and industrialists, establishing committees and controlling resource priorities in a manner that helped achieve the necessary production. The more difficult task was finding military manpower to fill at least 500,000 vacancies. Despite oppressive occupation policies, a significant number of young men from the Baltic states, Ukraine, and other non-Russian areas wanted to fight against Moscow. But at this stage in the war, the Schutzstaffel, SS, and Wehrmacht generally sought only ethnic Germans for their ranks. So the Nazi regime had to conscript more German industrial workers at precisely the time it sought to redouble production. In December 1941 alone, 282,300 German men, two-thirds of them working in the armaments industry, received orders for military service. Another 200,000 followed during the first half of 1942, as Germany lowered the ages for conscripted and voluntary military service to 18 and 17, respectively. Forced laborers from Russia were supposed to replace German farmers, who in turn shifted to the factories. But due to the general transportation shortage and the abuse prisoners had suffered at German hands, slave laborers were largely unavailable until well into 1942. Thus, despite its efforts, Germany could not make good all its losses, except in privileged formations such as the Waffen, combat, SS divisions, and the Grossdeutschland division. Colonel General Friedrich Fromm, who as head of the Reserve Army was responsible for training new recruits, suggested to Hitler that the available reinforcements be funneled to Army Group South, in preparation for an offensive to reach the Caucasus oil fields. This expedient brought the divisions of that army group to 80-85% of their authorized strengths. Even though some panzer divisions in 1st Panzer Army fielded only one tank battalion each, as opposed to the two or three battalions of 1941 divisions. To pay for this limited improvement in the southern divisions, however, 69 of the 75 infantry divisions in Army Groups North and Center shrank from 9 to 6 infantry battalions each, with their artillery batteries cut from 4 guns to 3, and proportionate reductions in horses and motor transport. Only the Luftwaffe began the 1942 campaign with substantially the same numbers it had possessed a year earlier, 2,635 aircraft in the east, as opposed to 2,770 in 1941. Even these figures concealed the loss of many experienced air crewmen. In March 1942, German factories began to produce the new Model F2 of the workhorse Panzer IV, which included a long-barreled 75mm gun with increased armor penetration. Yet such tanks remained a rarity in the field, as did the new 50mm anti-tank gun intended to replace the inadequate 37mm in infantry units. Thus, the armor-piercing capacity of the average German weapon remained inferior to the standard Soviet medium tank, the T-34-76, armed with a 76.2mm gun. Based on the Red Army's dismal initial performance in 1941, German commanders remained confident of their superior tactical ability at maneuver. Still, the Soviet counteroffensive before Moscow had been a great shock, and Hitler wished to ensure that his inexperienced recruits and shaken veterans experienced renewed success in several low-risk operations prior to the main Blau offensive. Satellite armies. If the German army was only moderately prepared for the second summer offensive, the other Axis armies were even weaker. The sole exception was the Finnish army, but once it reconquered the territory lost to Moscow in 1940, that army set up defensive positions and refused to move farther east. Despite a general contempt for the fighting qualities of the other satellites, German planners recognized the need for more troops in the upcoming campaign. Every step Germany took eastward would lengthen the front lines, especially the left flank of the long advance southeastward to the Caucasus. Given Germany's overall lack of manpower and reluctance to use local recruits, the only source of more troops was the Axis. Intense diplomatic pressure generated 52 non-German divisions for the 1942 campaign. 27 Romanian, 13 Hungarian, 9 Italian, and 2 Slovak divisions, plus the volunteer Spanish Blue Division. Benito Mussolini increased the Italian contingent in the east from 60,000 to 227,000, even though his commanders warned him that their forces were utterly unequipped for either the climate or the kind of mechanized warfare prevalent in Russia. From a smaller population, Romanian dictator Ion Antonescu made an even greater contribution, peaking at 267,000 men, including a significant Air Force contingent, by November 1942. However, the Romanian 1st Armored Division had lost many of its obsolescent tanks in 1941 and received only a few German vehicles as replacements. The Hungarian Armored Division was even weaker, including 85 locally assembled Czech 38T tanks and 22 Panzer I's, the tiny light tanks the German army had virtually retired from service. Thus, the satellite troops were lacking not courage, but weaponry. To complicate matters further, the Hungarian and Romanian troops were more interested in fighting each other than the Soviets, so the Italian Eighth Army had to be inserted between the two national contingents at the front. Differences in language, doctrine, and equipment meant that the German liaison officers to these Axis units had to possess diplomatic skills of the highest order. Rebuilding the Red Army. While the Wehrmacht struggled to rebuild its existing combat units, the Red Army faced the even greater task of creating new headquarters and organizations from nothing, reinventing itself in the midst of war. Under the shock of the initial German invasion, the Soviet headquarters of the Supreme High Command, usually referred to as the Stavka, had decided to simplify its force structure, creating smaller, less complex units at every level, to match the limited experience and span of control of the average Red commander and staff. The majority of new units raised during 1941 were rifle, infantry divisions, 6,000 to 10,000 men, or brigades, 4,000 to 6,000 men. In both instances, the new units were equipped with only rifles, machine guns, mortars, and a few guns or howitzers. Casualties sometimes reduced the effective strength of these divisions and brigades to as few as 1,000 bayonets, riflemen and sappers, each. The initial invasion had been even more disastrous to Soviet mechanized forces, although some remnants of the pre-war mechanized corps and tank divisions survived. All new tank production went to tank brigades and separate tank battalions intended to support the infantry. When the first such brigades appeared in September 1941, each had an authorized strength of 93 tanks. By December, that authorization had fallen to 46, while the separate battalions increased in strength from 29 to 36 tanks each. Beyond the tanks, these units received only a minimum of support and maintenance troops. Many of these brigades and battalions died as quickly as they sprang to life. But their surviving commanders and troops provided cadres whose hard-won experience was essential to the formation of larger organizations in 1942. The Red Army had a distinguished history of using horse cavalry, which could move where swamps, snow, and fuel shortages blocked motorized and mechanized formations. During the first 8 months of the war, the People's Commissariat of Defense, Narodny Komissariat Obrony, or NKO, fielded 15 cavalry corps consisting of 2 to 3 small divisions each. Such units had proved effective operating behind German lines under the confused conditions of the winter of 1941 to 1942. Cavalry could not actually fight on horseback, and such forces often had no weapons larger than a 50-millimeter mortar, making them vulnerable in conventional battle. However, horses still facilitated movement in frozen and swampy terrain. Stalin and his generals were convinced they needed larger, combined-arms mechanized units to fight the German panzers on equal terms. Fortunately, Soviet industry provided the tools to build these new units. Having packed up and moved beyond the Ural Mountains soon after the German invasion, many armaments factories somehow managed to resume production early in 1942. 3,000 aircraft, 4,500 tanks, 14,000 field pieces, 50,000 mortars, and thousands of additional weapons came off the assembly lines between January and May. Some of these weapons were obsolescent, such as the T-60 light tanks, but the Soviets continued to produce them simply because they were easy to build on automobile assembly lines. Overall, however, the Red Army achieved a renaissance in armaments, significantly supplemented by lend-lease equipment provided by Britain and the United States. American all-wheel drive trucks were especially important to supply mobile forces once they left their railroad lines behind. Organizing this wealth of equipment into a new generation of mechanized units was the task of Lieutenant General of Tank Forces Yakov Nikolaevich Fedorenko, chief of the Red Army's main auto-armored directorate. On March 31, 1942, Fedorenko formed the first four tank corps, which were actually small combined arms divisions. By December, there were 28 such tank corps, many built by expanding a veteran tank brigade of 1941. Each of the first four tank corps consisted of two tank brigades, one truck-mounted rifle brigade, and very limited support, for a total strength of 5,603 men and 100 tanks, 20 KV heavy, 40 T-34 medium, and 40 T-60 light. Almost immediately, however, Fedorenko added a third tank brigade plus various combat support elements necessary for sustained operations. By July, a typical tank corps included three tank brigades of 53 tanks each, 32 medium and 21 light, one motorized rifle brigade, a motorcycle reconnaissance battalion, battalions of mortars, anti-aircraft guns, and multiple rocket launchers, guards mortars, the famed Katyushas, a combat engineer, sapper, company, and somewhat later a transportation company with two mobile repair teams. The total authorized strength of this organization grew to as much as 7,600 men and 180 tanks. Even these units proved to be too armor-heavy, lacking infantry and armored personnel carriers, APCs, for sustained operations. Beginning in September, therefore, Fedorenko began to organize another type of formation known as a mechanized corps. Again, there were a number of organizational variants, but all mechanized corps had a nucleus of three mechanized brigades, each with a regiment of 39 medium tanks as well as trucked infantry, plus one or two tank brigades or regiments, and most of the supporting arms found in a tank corps. The mechanized corps, which still lacked APCs, were authorized 175 to 204 tanks each, depending on the exact table of organization. The tank and mechanized corps were roughly equivalent to panzer divisions, although the German units had more infantry, APCs, and artillery than the tank corps. Such units were increasingly effective at the tactical level, but the Red Army wanted a larger organization, equivalent to a German motorized corps or panzer army, for sustained deeper attacks at the operational rather than tactical level of war. On May 25, 1942, the NKO combined some of the newly created tank corps into the 3rd and 5th Tank Armies. Two additional tank armies, 1st and 4th, formed in July. But they were thrown into battle before their organization was complete and therefore suffered heavy damage at German hands. In any event, the structure of these tank armies was experimental and varied widely due to shortages of trucks and other equipment. As a result, these first tank armies included horse cavalry and rifle divisions whose mobility and armored protection were far inferior to those of the tank corps. A typical 1942 tank army included two or three tank corps, one cavalry corps, and 2 to 6 rifle divisions, plus supporting units. Their average strength was 35,000 men, 350 to 500 tanks, and 150 to 200 towed artillery pieces. Fedorenko and other senior leaders intended for these new organizations to permit a return to the pre-war doctrine of deep operations, a sophisticated set of concepts that had languished after Stalin purged many of its advocates in 1937. In theory, the experience of 1941 had prepared the surviving tank commanders to manage these new tank corps and tank armies. In practice, however, the commanders, and especially their staff officers, still had much to learn before they could concentrate, maneuver, and resupply their troops with the skill exhibited by the Germans. After a number of disasters beginning in May, the Red Army gradually learned from its experience, creating more effective organizations, tactics, and staff procedures by the end of 1942. The same could be said for other Soviet efforts to improve field performance, such as concentrating artillery, tanks, and infantry on narrow frontages, both to halt German penetrations and to create their own breakthroughs when they attempted to counterattack. Yet time after time in 1942, Stalin and the Stavka badgered field commanders into attacking before their troops and supplies were completely assembled and coordinated. The resulting failures only confirmed German stereotypes about the incompetence of their opponents, making the November encirclement of Stalingrad all the more startling when it occurred. Meanwhile, just as in the Wehrmacht, the Soviet decision to field these mechanized units meant that the average rifle division had a low priority for replacement soldiers and new equipment. The one exception was units with the Guards designation, which conferred not only supply priority but also better food and pay. The Stavka generally awarded this designation to successful divisions and higher units, rewarding its most skillful commanders. Just like the mechanized forces, the Guards units became a means to return to pre-war complexity in doctrine and organization. The 1st Guards Army was sacrificed in the defense of Stalingrad, but by late fall 1942, a new generation of such armies began to form, and they were authorized the full structure of corps, divisions, and fire support that the Red Army had jettisoned during the crisis of 1941. In terms of weaponry, newly produced 45mm anti-tank guns were much more effective against German armor. Yet the Soviet tank designs, like their German counterparts, were almost identical to those of the previous year, which meant that the Red Army retained a technical superiority over its opponents. Thus, the T-34 medium tank had both thicker armor and better armament, a 76.2mm high-velocity main gun, than the German Panzer III, and the short-barreled variant of the Panzer IV, although its engine and transmission were inferior. The T-34 still had significant design problems with regard to its turret layout, but its ability to operate in extreme weather with minimal maintenance made it a formidable weapon. The KV-1 heavy tank, with the same main gun and even thicker armor, was virtually invulnerable to anything smaller than the famous German 88mm anti-aircraft gun. However, because the KV-1 required a massive investment in material and production man-hours, Fedorenko focused on increasing the production of T-34s. The Red Air Force also began to recover its strength during the spring of 1942. Its new commander, Lieutenant General of Aviation Forces Alexander Alexandrovich Novikov, established larger tactical headquarters, including 1st Air Army and a number of shock aviation groups, to mass aircraft under centralized control. However, the Red Air Force lagged behind its ground counterparts and did not present effective opposition to the Luftwaffe until the fall. Correlation of forces. It is almost impossible to make a genuine one-to-one comparison between Axis and Soviet forces in 1942. Each side had other theaters to defend, France, North Africa, and the Far East, and each had some strategic reserves. The Soviet Supreme High Command, VGK, reserve was almost exponentially larger than its German counterpart. Even after committing many of these reserves during the winter campaigns, the VGK reserve still numbered 218,276 men on May 1st. It would soon grow much larger, a factor that repeatedly prevented strategic German victory. Moreover, many of the promised Axis satellite divisions had yet to reach the front lines in the east when the summer battles began. In any event, since the 1942 campaign focused on only the southern portion of the theater of operations, forces on both sides could shift from one region to another as the situation required. Suffice it to say that in early April 1942, Germany had approximately 2.5 million troops in the east, reinforced by almost a million Allied troops either on hand or en route. 450,000 Finns and 440,000 Romanians, Hungarians, Italians, and Slovaks. By June, Army Group South, including 11th Army in the Crimea, would grow to 71 German divisions, 46 infantry, 4 Jäger, light infantry, 2 mountain, 7 motorized, including 2 SS, 9 panzer, and 3 rear area security, plus an SS motorized brigade. In addition, there were 22 Axis divisions, including the Romanian 1st Armored and Slovak Mobile divisions, giving Field Marshal Fedor von Bock's Army Group South a potential of 1 million German and 300,000 Axis soldiers. His weakened panzer divisions totaled 1,700 tanks, of which 300 were obsolete Panzer II light tanks. The 4th Air Fleet supported Army Group South with almost half, 1,002, of the aircraft in the east, although only 548 of this fleet were operational on May 20, 1942. The Soviet forces opposite Army Group South on June 1 included 4.5 fronts, Bryansk, one-half, southwestern, and southern, later backed up by the North Caucasus and Transcaucasus, numbering over 1.7 million troops. Among them, these commands mustered 102 rifle divisions, 19 separate rifle brigades, 5 cavalry corps, 19 cavalry divisions, 8 tank corps, with 24 tank and 8 motorized rifle brigades, 1 separate motorized rifle brigade, and 29 separate tank brigades. Behind them stood the VGK reserve, which included 1 tank and 7 reserve armies, including 3 tank corps with 8 tank brigades and 4 separate tank brigades, roughly half of which were in place behind the fronts in the southern Soviet Union. Many of these formations, especially the corps and army headquarters to control the mechanized brigades, were still in the process of activation and training. Across the entire front, the Red Army's field and reserve units reported 4,197 tanks on May 1st. Another 5,128 newly produced tanks had not yet reached the combat units. Moreover, of the 4,197 tanks in the field, many were outside the region of the principal German offensive, and more than half of them were light tanks of limited capacity. In practice, therefore, in the southern region, the Red Army began the second year of the war with an overall tank ratio, in comparison to the Germans, of less than 2-1. The Two Dictators. Popular histories of the Soviet-German conflict frequently focus on Adolf Hitler and Joseph Stalin, blaming them for every mistake and defeat. Although both men made significant military errors, the reality of their leadership was both more nuanced and more successful than the legends suggest. To begin with, one must recognize that the ultimate leader, the Führer or Vosged, had to lead, both to satisfy his propaganda image and to discourage any potential rivals. Men who took and held power by the threat of violence could not afford to appear passive or indecisive. Moreover, Hitler in particular had accumulated a number of diplomatic and military successes that encouraged even his closest associates to assume that the Führer really did know best in any crisis. Living up to this image sometimes compelled him to interfere in matters the general staff officers had always considered their private area of expertise. Hitler was a gifted amateur, while his professional subordinates were by no means infallible, as evidenced by his decision, perhaps for the wrong reasons, to defend in place outside Moscow. That said, until mid-1942, Hitler often deferred to his commanders and advisers, so long as these individuals were generally effective. Even when Hitler issued a military pronouncement, he did not necessarily enforce that edict if his generals provided a logical explanation for a different course of action. Halder and the field commanders continued to circumvent the dictator's desires, often without penalty or punishment. However, the Reichel incident represented both a genuine lack of security awareness and a deliberate intent to thwart the essence of Hitler's instructions. As the 1942 campaign progressed without a decisive victory, the dictator began to suspect that his subordinates were overly cautious at best and perhaps genuinely obstructionist. He became increasingly impatient at what he perceived to be a closing strategic window, perhaps the last chance to establish his empire on a stable basis before American and Soviet production overwhelmed the Germans. From this perspective, he became more and more convinced that his subordinates were letting tactical opportunities slip away. Small wonder, then, that he relieved a number of senior commanders during the campaign while inserting himself more aggressively into it. Not surprisingly, Stalin's conduct was a mirror image of Hitler's. His initial response to the defeats of 1941 was to centralize his control further while increasing the power of political officers and secret police and imprisoning or executing failed commanders on suspicion of treason. By the end of 1941, the Soviet leader had identified a small number of men, such as Deputy Commander-in-Chief G.K. Zhukov, Chief of the General Staff A.M. Vasilevsky, and Front and Main Direction Commander S.K. Timoshenko, who possessed the necessary competence and ruthlessness to succeed in battle. Even then, however, Stalin retained control of key decisions, such as committing the strategic reserve outside Moscow. Over the course of 1942, the very German failures that bothered Hitler eventually prompted Stalin to give greater trust and authority to his generals. German leaders. Hitler's senior leaders in 1942 were all experienced generals. The two army group commanders most involved in the upcoming offensive were typical products of the older German officer corps. Field Marshals Fedor von Bock and Siegmund Wilhelm List were both 62 years old, born in 1880. Both were veterans of World War I, the General Staff system, and the interwar German Army. Being slightly senior in rank, Bock had been given the plum assignment of Commander of Army Group Center during the Barbarossa campaign. Hitler expressed his continuing faith in Bock by posting him at the head of Army Group South for the Blau campaign. When, as planned, this campaign achieved its initial successes, Army Group South would split into two parts, with Bock heading Army Group B to advance into the bend of the Don River, and List, who had spent the previous year commanding in the Balkans, assuming leadership of the newly formed Army Group A. This new headquarters was to direct the drive to the Caucasus oil fields in the later phases of the Blau campaign. Below the army group level, there were a number of younger leaders, one in the Luftwaffe and six in the army, who would figure prominently in the campaign. Most of them began the campaign with the rank of colonel general, just below field marshal. Wolfram Freiherr, Baron von Richthofen, a cousin of the famous World War I aviator, was born in 1895 and served as an army officer on both fronts during World War I, before becoming a pilot. In early 1942, he commanded Flieger Corps, Air Corps 8, the Luftwaffe's premier close air support formation that reinforced the main army effort in various locations. Throughout the 1942 campaign, Richthofen was frustrated and impatient with ground commanders who relied on his aircraft to blast through any Soviet resistance. Like most air power advocates, he considered this a poor use of his airmen's potential power. Nonetheless, he went to unusual lengths to coordinate not only with German army commanders, but also with their Romanian allies. Colonel General Hermann Hoth, born in 1885, had been an infantry commander before leading the 15th Motorized Corps in the 1940 campaign. During the Barbarossa campaign, Hoth commanded 3rd Panzer Group and 17th Army, surviving the December crisis in which many of his contemporaries lost their positions. For the 1942 campaign, Hoth commanded 4th Panzer Army, which was key to both the initial advance under Blau and the later vain efforts to relieve the encirclement at Stalingrad. Colonel General Fritz Erich von Manstein had the most meteoric rise of any officer on either side during 1942. When the fighting resumed in May, he commanded a virtual sideshow, the German-Romanian 11th Army in the Crimea. 6 months later, he was Germany's last hope. A field marshal leading the improvised Army Group Don that eventually pushed the Red Army back in early 1943. Born Erich von Lewinsky in 1887, he assumed the name of his stepfather and rose as an Imperial Guardsman and General Staff officer. Manstein was an abrasive, demanding, anti-Semitic leader who was nonetheless a brilliant planner and tactician. Self-confident to the point of arrogance, he rose rapidly once the war began, commanding the 56th Motorized Corps in 1941 before leading 11th Army to victory in the Crimea. If Manstein had an equal as an operational commander, it was probably the handsome Colonel General Ewald Paul Ludwig von Kleist. Born into a long line of Prussian soldier aristocrats in 1881, Kleist was a committed royalist and Christian who did not hide his distaste for Nazism. This attitude led to his temporary retirement in 1938. Once the war began, however, the former cavalryman was recalled to active duty, where he proved to be a consummate operational commander. This was reflected most famously in Panzergruppe Kleist, the four-corps formation that broke through the Ardennes and raced to Dunkirk in 1940. Kleist then commanded 1st Panzer Group, later redesignated 1st Panzer Army in 1941 to 1942. By the time the Red Army counterattacked at Stalingrad, Kleist had succeeded List in command of Army Group A in the Caucasus. While Manstein fought to relieve Stalingrad, Kleist conducted a brilliant fighting retreat from that region, a performance that earned him a marshal's baton. Perhaps the most famous and controversial name associated with the Stalingrad tragedy was Friedrich Wilhelm Ernst Paulus, sometimes erroneously identified as von Paulus, who commanded the German 6th Army in that city. Born in 1890, Paulus was an intelligent workaholic from a middle-class background who aspired to a place in the aristocratic officer corps of Imperial Germany. In 1912, he acquired quasi-aristocratic status by marrying a Romanian noblewoman. Tall, lean, and always immaculately dressed, the young soldier was the model of a German officer. By 1918, he was a captain who had served as a staff officer at battalion and regimental level. Between the World Wars, Paulus left the general staff only twice for brief, obligatory assignments with troops, commanding at company and battalion level. The latter assignment was particularly auspicious, since Lieutenant Colonel Paulus commanded the 3rd Motor Transport Battalion, the model for future armored reconnaissance units at a time, 1934 to 1935, when the Versailles Treaty still forbade Germany to possess tanks. Thereafter, he reverted to his normal role, becoming in succession chief of staff of 3 key organizations: Panzer Forces in 1935, Heinz Guderian's 16th Motorized Corps in 1938, and Army Group 4 in 1939. For the invasion of Poland, Colonel Paulus was a chief of staff yet again, this time for the German 10th Army, commanded by Colonel General Walter von Reichenau, an early convert to Nazism. The two men's personalities were perfectly complementary. Paulus provided the methodical staff work that kept the headquarters functioning, while the earthy and assertive Reichenau led his troops from the front. After the 1940 campaign, Paulus reached the penultimate position in his career as 1st Oberquartiermeister, or Deputy Chief of the General Staff. As such, he helped plan for Operation Barbarossa, although when he wargamed that plan, he reluctantly concluded that the Germans might well fail to achieve a decisive victory over the Red Army. The introverted, refined Paulus was never comfortable arguing with coarser, more assertive men, such as Hitler and Reichenau, but he recognized their considerable ability. They, in turn, valued his loyal service as a meticulous subordinate. In retrospect, therefore, it appears almost inevitable that Paulus would have a starring role in the forthcoming campaign. On January 5, 1942, the man who had never commanded anything more significant than a peacetime battalion received a promotion to Colonel General and command of 6th Army, one of the spearheads of Operation Blau. Despite his inexperience, he proved worthy of the task. At the time, Reichenau was Paulus's immediate superior as commander of Army Group South. Reichenau undoubtedly expected that they would reprise their respective roles from earlier operations, with Reichenau leading from the front while his protégé applied his usual thoroughness to the details of the operation. Less than 2 weeks after Paulus received his new position, however, Reichenau died unexpectedly, probably as a result of exercising in the extreme cold of the Russian winter. Fedor von Bock succeeded him as Army Group Commander, and Paulus was on his own. Colonel General Maximilian Freiherr von Weichs an dem Glonn commanded 2nd Army during the first year of the war, and then led an ad hoc army group that bore his name during the initial phases of Operation Blau. Like Kleist, Weichs was somewhat old for field command, having been born in 1881. Also like Kleist, he was a cavalryman and rather outspoken, in his case, insisting on the army's political neutrality. A corps commander in the Polish campaign, he rose to Field Army Command in 1941 and helped encircle the Red Army's southwestern front at Kiev in September. Weichs was known as the anti-aircraft general for his innovative use of the Luftwaffe's 88mm anti-aircraft guns in a ground combat role. Illness took him away from his command in November 1941, but he returned a month later in time to contain the first Red Army winter offensive. The most junior army commander in this group was Colonel General Richard Ruoff. Born in 1891, Ruoff commanded the 5th Army Corps from 1939 through 1941. As such, he halted the counterattack of two Soviet mechanized corps near Minsk in June 1941 and assisted in the encirclement battle of Smolensk a month later. This performance led him to command Army Group Center's 4th Panzer Army in January 1942 and Army Group South's 17th Army 5 months later. In the latter position, Ruoff conducted one of the Germans' deepest advances into the Caucasus Mountains. One key difference between the two sides was the relative experience of German commanders in their current positions. Because of equipment and manpower shortages, Germany could form only a few new units, such as converting 1st Cavalry Division into 24th Panzer in 1942. Thus, many German commanders led the same units, or at least units of similar size and complexity, in both 1941 and 1942. By contrast, many Soviet commanders and their staff officers took on greater responsibilities and had to grow into their new positions. This was especially true of the successful tank brigade headquarters that now supervised tank corps and even armies. Many of the Soviet failures in 1942 were due to this inexperience in critical tasks, such as operations planning and logistical support. Red Army Leaders. In contrast to their foes, the senior leaders of the Red Army were a much more diverse mixture of groups and individuals. Almost all of them were younger than their German counterparts. This included even the most senior Red officers, such as Marshal S.K. Timoshenko, born in 1895, who had Stalin's confidence because of their performance in the Russian Civil War 2 decades earlier. However, these veterans generally failed to adjust to the demands of mechanized high-intensity conflict. Stalin's most trusted lieutenants, Deputy Commander-in-Chief G.K. Zhukov, born in 1896, and Chief of the General Staff, A.M. Vasilevsky, born in 1895, have already been mentioned and are considered in detail in connection with strategic planning in Chapter 2. Political officer Nikita Sergeyevich Khrushchev, born in 1894, had also earned the dictator's confidence before the war, and managed to retain it in battle by a combination of courage, competence, and political agility. Below the highest levels, a number of front, army group, and field army commanders came and went, often relieved before they could gain control of their wavering formations. For our purposes, however, three men commanded the key fronts seeking to halt the German offensive in 1942. Lieutenant General Filip Ivanovich Golikov was only 42 years old when he took command of the Bryansk Front in April of that year. Golikov had had a varied career, including political commissar, mechanized corps commander, head of the General Staff's main intelligence directorate, Glavne razvedivatelne upravlenie, or GRU, where he managed to keep his job while warning Stalin of the impending German invasion, and Stalin's personal representative to London and Washington in 1941. He returned home in time to command 4th Shock Army successfully in the spring of 1942. This performance, plus Golikov's political survival skills, led to his elevation to front command. The second such commander was 43-year-old Lieutenant General Rodion Yakovlevich Malinovsky, who had begun his career in 1914, served in the Russian Imperial Expeditionary Corps to France, and returned home to fight in the Russian Civil War. A peacetime cavalry corps commander, Malinovsky also served in the Spanish Civil War. His performance as a rifle corps commander in 1941 was more successful than that of many of his contemporaries, leading to his rapid promotion, including command of 6th Army, August to December 1941, and of the Southern Front thereafter. As such, he had helped defeat Kleist's 1st Panzer Army at Rostov in November, and then pushed the Germans west to the Kharkov area during the counteroffensive. The oldest of the three front commanders, Lieutenant General Dmitry Timofeyevich Koslov, was 44 years of age when he became commander of the Transcaucasus Front in August 1941. A non-commissioned officer during World War I and the Civil War, Koslov had commanded battalions and regiments and fought against Central Asian insurgents. He attended the Frunze General Staff Academy in the 1920s and returned to teach at that school during the 1930s. Koslov commanded the Transcaucasus Military District during the first half of 1941 and then became front commander of the same area upon mobilization. In the latter capacity, he had startled the Germans with a successful amphibious operation to regain control of the Kerch Peninsula in the eastern Crimea during December 1941. Beyond these three men, one must include the front commander who directed the final destruction of 6th Army, Lieutenant General Konstantin Konstantinovich Rokossovsky. Born in Warsaw and a veteran of the Tsar's army in World War I, he had risen in the Red Army as a cavalryman until he was swept up in the Great Purge and spent 3 years in prison after being implicated by another prisoner. Released in March 1940, he commanded a mechanized corps and a field army during 1941. He began the 1942 campaign as commander of the Bryansk Front, but in September, Zhukov brought him to Stalingrad. There, Rokossovsky assumed various positions, ultimately commanding the Don Front that surrounded and destroyed 6th Army between November 1942 and February 1943. In addition to these front commanders, at least 15 other officers led field armies during the 1942 campaign, and some of them went on to command at higher levels. Almost all of them had benefited from the 1937 to 1941 purge of senior Soviet officers. Although many of these men figured in the events that followed, three deserve special mention because of their performance in 1942 and after. In terms of their background and behavior, they were typical of their peers. First was Kirill Semyonovich Moskalenko, a 39-year-old major general who assumed command of the Southwestern Front's 38th Army in March 1942. An enlisted cavalryman during the Russian Civil War, Moskalenko held a variety of commands in every active theater, including the Winter War with Finland, 1939 to 1940, the occupation of Roman Bessarabia, 1940, and the disastrous Kiev encirclement, 1941. After surviving Kiev, his pre-war experience with mechanized forces led to his command of a cavalry mechanized group, followed by leadership of 6th Army in the partially successful Barvenkovo-Lozovaya offensive early in 1942. The two generals most responsible for the defense of Stalingrad were not yet on stage when Operation Blau began. Both had suffered disgrace in previous defeats, and both were thrown into battle after more favored commanders had failed. Colonel General Andrei Ivanovich Eremenko, born in 1892, had been drafted into the Tsar's army in 1913 and volunteered for the Red Army in 1918. Like many successful Red officers, he had served in Semyon Budyonny's cavalry army during the Civil War and remained in that branch, commanding 6th Cavalry Corps when the USSR invaded eastern Poland in 1939. Eremenko was wounded 3 times between July 1941 and January 1942, twice while commanding fronts that vainly tried to halt the German advance to Moscow. In August 1942, he became commander of the Southeastern Front, later redesignated the Stalingrad Front. There, assisted by his commissar, Khrushchev, Eremenko had the grim task of feeding units into the meat grinder of urban warfare. Their front headquarters was located on the east bank of the Volga throughout the fall of 1942, allowing them to remain aloof from the tactical battle itself. The actual defense of Stalingrad fell to Lieutenant Colonel Vasily Ivanovich Chuikov, the 41-year-old commander of 62nd Army. The son of a peasant, Chuikov had risen to command a regiment during the Russian Civil War. Thereafter, his career was divided almost equally among military schools, troop commands, and repeated assignments as an advisor in Mongolia and China. Disgraced as commander of 9th Army during the Finnish Winter War, Chuikov went into de facto exile as the Soviet military attaché to the nationalist Chinese government. Even when he wrangled his way back to European Russia after the German invasion, an automobile accident sidelined him for more than a year. Thus, he did not meet the Germans in battle until the summer of 1942, when he managed to salvage something from the repeated defeats of that period. His hard-headed perseverance and competence led him to the perilous command of 62nd Army in September, just as the defense of Stalingrad began. Chuikov was an energetic rather than a brilliant soldier, but he had a knack for inspiring his subordinates. In the house-to-house struggle for the ruins of the city, the earthy, pragmatic Chuikov proved at least as effective as the cerebral, meticulous Paulus. The German soldier. Germany's soldiers, like its commanders, were a mixed bag of veteran professionals and new enthusiasts. After 3 years of uninterrupted triumph, the winter campaign of 1941-42 had cost the German army in experience and confidence, as well as in blood and equipment. To meet the urgent need for replacements in the spring of 1942, infantry divisions received soldiers with as little as 2 months of training and scant time in their new units. An army that prided itself on tactical skill and training now had to deal with half-trained recruits and inexperienced units. This began a deadly spiral that continued for the rest of the war. Inexperienced, inadequately trained soldiers were more likely to become casualties than were experienced ones, which led to a renewed demand for replacements and forced the training base to send out men with steadily decreasing periods of training. The high turnover in manpower, with its resulting influx of younger Germans, also contributed to a trend that existed even in 1941, what might be termed the Nazification of the German army. With certain exceptions, such as Reichenau, during the first part of the war, senior commanders were still the products of the conservative, professional army of World War I and the Weimar Republic, albeit this conservatism was often tinged with old-fashioned anti-Semitism. As time went on, however, many company-grade officers and rank-and-file soldiers had grown up under the Nazi regime and often reflected Nazi attitudes. They tended to regard their opponents as uncivilized subhumans, an attitude that encouraged the Germans to fight with great bravery because they feared capture more than death. Yet this same belief structure had a darker side. Isolated from German society in a strange and frightening land, German soldiers were guilty of constant callousness and casual atrocities against Soviet civilians as well as prisoners of war. Despite later denials, in practice, their senior commanders did little or nothing to correct these excesses. The Soviet Soldier. As the training level of the average German soldier declined, that of his Soviet counterpart rose. Wartime training in the Red Army varied greatly, depending on the date and location of entry into service. In general, units formed in the interior had achieved some level of competence and cohesion before they entered battle. The legends of draconian discipline were exaggerated. The main function of blocking detachments behind the front lines was not to punish deserters, but to return stragglers to their units. Thousands of Soviet soldiers still died in the summer of 1942, but a year of painful experience gave both the surviving troops and their commanders a growing measure of competence. Soviet histories tend to glorify the socialist spirit of the Red Army, and indeed, millions of the bravest and most competent soldiers were rewarded with membership in the Communist Party. Reading between the lines, however, the average Soviet soldier was apparently actuated by the more traditional motives of loyalty to comrades and patriotic defense of the nation. Indeed, beginning in 1941, the Soviet state consciously identified itself with Mother Russia in the struggle against the invaders, gaining a loyalty that Marxism alone had never inspired. There were, of course, misunderstandings and friction between the officer corps, largely Great Russian, and various minority groups from all over the Soviet Union. Some nationalities provided significant numbers of armed auxiliaries to support the Germans, or, like the Ukrainians, fought as guerrillas against both sides. However, the Germans' harsh occupation policies and their initial reluctance to arm Slavs tended to drive many potential supporters into the Soviet camp. The desperate struggle to defend the motherland meant that women, as well as men, bore the burdens of war. The NKO was initially reluctant to enlist large numbers of females, often restricting them to traditional but dangerous tasks such as medics, drivers, and communications operators. In the course of 1942, however, the government gradually widened the use of female soldiers, eventually training them as anti-aircraft troops, pilots, snipers, and even tank drivers. Like their male counterparts, these women exhibited the traditional Russian ability to endure unimaginable hardship while fighting with great intensity. In 1942, therefore, the average German soldier might have been marginally more competent than his Soviet counterpart, but neither side needed lessons from the other about the ferocity of a struggle for survival. Chapter 2. Plans and Preparations. In retrospect, both the German and Soviet plans for 1942 appear unrealistic and overly ambitious. Perhaps subconsciously, each side expected the other to display the weaknesses of the previous year. Senior German commanders and staffs, at least at the level of the OKH, Oberkommando des Heeres, the Army General Staff, and OKW, Oberkommando der Wehrmacht, the joint staff responsible for all theaters except the one in the East, assumed that the Red Army would make the same bumbling mistakes it had committed in 1941, when Soviet units had often allowed themselves to be surrounded and then fell apart. Stalin, the Stavka, and many senior Red commanders subconsciously expected the Germans to be in the same parlous state they had been in during the winter months, undermanned, undersupplied, and almost immobilized by equipment failures. Both sides would be disappointed. The strategic picture. Prior to the 1941 invasion of Russia, Adolf Hitler had dominated Western Europe, with only Great Britain still openly opposing him. One year later, Germany was fighting the two largest industrial powers in the world, the United States and the Soviet Union, in two separate theaters. Thus, even as the OKH and OKW prepared for a 1942 offensive in the East, they had to consider the demands of other theaters of war. The United States, which had just begun its mobilization, had to balance any actions in Europe against the more pressing needs of the Pacific War. Still, Hitler could not rid himself of the fear that the British, aided by the Americans, might attempt to reduce the pressure on the Soviets by launching a limited invasion of Norway or France. The Soviet government repeatedly demanded such a second front, dismissing the logistical and tactical problems involved. Hitler's fears were not entirely unfounded. From his perspective, which his army commanders in the East rarely understood, any attack in the West would pose a much more immediate threat to the core of the German Reich than an equivalent enemy advance in Russia because of the relative distances involved. Therefore, at a March 28th conference on the upcoming Blau campaign, the dictator insisted that several high-priority units remain in the West as a strategic reserve. These included the Luftwaffe's improbably named Hermann Göring Parachute Panzer Division, as well as three reconstituting panzer divisions. Hitler also focused on the difficulties of resupplying Field Marshal Erwin Rommel's small Afrika Corps in North Africa. In particular, he diverted significant air assets to help the Italians bombard the British island of Malta, which straddled the sea lanes between Italy and North Africa. Germany's strategic position in the spring of 1942 was not completely negative. The United States' sudden entry into the war had given the German submarine service an unprecedented opportunity to attack the poorly protected merchant shipping in U.S. waters. Hitler could reasonably expect these U-boat victories to damage the U.S. and British economies and delay the deployment of American forces to Europe. Yet the very complexity of a wider war, with conflicting demands on resources for U-boats, for North Africa, and for Western Europe, complicated decision-making, and made Germany less likely to accept risk than it had been in 1941. Even in the East, the Germans had to be more disciplined, focusing on one objective rather than attempting to capture everything at once, as they had done the previous year. In the North, the besieged city of Leningrad beckoned. Capture of this great city, birthplace of the Bolshevik Revolution, would not only yield psychological advantages, but also permit the German troops to link up with their capable allies, the Finns. With luck, a northern offensive might cut off the Soviet Arctic seaports and thereby reduce the flow of Allied lend-lease supplies into the Soviet Union. As a result of the confused winter fighting, there were also large pockets of surrounded Germans to be rescued, and similarly, significant groupings of Soviet troops that might be choked off behind German lines. All this promised, at the very least, to shorten the German defensive lines and thereby free forces for further offensive operations. South of Kharkov, that great industrial city in the northern Ukraine, German intelligence analysts detected a combination of enemy troops near a westward bend of the front at the northern Donets River. This protrusion, the remnant of the Soviet Barvenkovo-Losovaya offensive of January and February 1942, was variously known as the Izium or Barvenkovo salient. The Germans suspected correctly that their opponents intended to use this salient as a bridgehead for offensive operations. Therefore, German planners wished to eliminate both the salient and any Soviet troop concentrations before launching a major offensive. The German plan for this preliminary attack was known as Operation Friedericus, but the Soviets preempted it with their own failed offensive in May 1942. Finally, the Germans had to clear two Soviet positions on the Crimean Peninsula. The fortified city of Sevastopol, which had repulsed Axis attacks in 1941, posed multiple threats. Its port allowed the Red Navy to harass the German-occupied coastlines, while its airfield was a natural base for the Red Air Force to attack the vital oil fields of Ploiești, Romania. In addition to Sevastopol, the Soviets held the Kerch Peninsula at the extreme eastern end of the Crimea. To eliminate this threat, Erich von Manstein's combined German-Romanian 11th Army planned Operation Trappenjagd, Bustard Hunt. Large German siege guns and significant Luftwaffe ground support aircraft gathered to assist in clearing both Kerch and Sevastopol. Fall Blau. All these possible objectives, from Leningrad to Sevastopol, were sideshows to the main objective for 1942, seizure of the Caucasus oil fields. The small oil field at Maikop and the much larger one centered around Baku, in what is now Azerbaijan, together produced approximately 80% of all Soviet petroleum products. Seizing them would not only strike a major blow against the USSR, but also solve the greatest limitation on the German economy and war machine. In October 1941, Germany had managed to refuel its spearheads only by coercing the Romanians into providing more of their limited fuel supply. By 1942, the German and Italian surface fleets were almost immobilized by a lack of fuel, and the U-boats were hampered by a 50% reduction in supplies. For Hitler and his military and economic planners, the Caucasus oil fields appeared to be the solution to most of their problems. The Caucasus offered other advantages to the German prosecution of the war. The region contained not only petroleum, but also extensive reserves of coal, peat, manganese, and other materials. However, moving bulk materials from such a remote location would pose a formidable problem. In addition, the Caucasus was the natural gateway to the Middle East. Its seizure would eliminate another major conduit of lend-lease aid coming through Iran. Some Germans even dreamed of a gigantic pincer movement, pushing south beyond the Caucasus to link up with Rommel's Afrika Korps east of the Suez Canal and seize control of the vast oil reserves of the Middle East. For all these reasons, control of the Caucasus had been part of German thinking since July 1940, when Hitler initiated planning for the invasion of the Soviet Union. Long-range aerial reconnaissance took extensive photographs of the region as the Barbarossa plan progressed. Yet by October 1941, it was clear that Germany could not reach the oil fields that year. So the OKH pushed the date for such an operation forward into 1942. Throughout the difficult defensive battles during the winter of 1941-42, Hitler frequently returned to this prospect, insisting that specialized mountain troops remain ready to push through the Caucasus as early as possible the following spring. Once the winter battles shuddered to a halt, the plan for the next campaign took final form. On March 28, 1942, General Halder, as head of the OKH, presented Hitler with the draft for the summer offensive. Originally codenamed Fall, plan or case, Siegfried, this plan had already received the more neutral name Blau, blue, apparently because the failure of Barbarossa had made further references to German mythology seem embarrassingly grandiose. After the dictator commented extensively on the OKH proposal, General Alfred Jodl, the operations chief of the Wehrmacht High Command, OKW, revised the plan and again presented it to the dictator a week later. Halder and Jodl had produced the kind of plan that the German general staff system expected. It established an overall concept of operations and responsibilities of subordinate headquarters, but left many decisions to the field commanders, especially Bock as head of Army Group South. However, as noted in the prologue, Hitler was developing some suspicions about his general's willingness to fulfill his intent. He therefore insisted that Jodl add detailed instructions about the conduct of the campaign. The result was a curious mixture of operations order, strategic evaluation, and wishful thinking. Führer Directive, Weisung, No. 41, issued on April 5, 1942, assumed that the Soviet Union had been so exhausted by the previous year of warfare that one additional push would rupture the Red Army and clear the way to the Caucasus oil fields. Still, the directive tacitly recognized that no single campaign was likely to crush the Soviet Union completely, which had been the goal of Operation Barbarossa. Instead, the most Hitler could hope for was to destroy Stalin's military forces and push the remnants of the communist regime eastward toward the Ural Mountains. The stated objective of the 1942 campaign was to wipe out the entire defense potential remaining to the Soviets and to cut them off, as far as possible, from their most important centers of war industry. To this end, Hitler envisioned another series of encirclement battles, but re-emphasized his 1941 concern that these pockets be sealed off tightly so the Soviets could not escape to fight again. The directive discussed all aspects of the 1942 effort in the East, beginning with a renewed assault on Leningrad, a series of limited offensives to straighten the German lines, and preparatory operations to eliminate Soviet capabilities in the Crimea and around Izium. Only after these operations reached completion would the Germans launch the main offensive for the summer. The distances involved were so great, and the transportation lines so tenuous, that the operation would be conducted in phases, later referred to as Blau 1, Blau 2, and so on. This portion of the directive was still expressed in fairly general terms. Only later did the field commanders assign specific tasks to the various maneuver armies. What follows, therefore, is an attempt to flesh out the ambiguous outline of the original plan. What we now refer to as Blau 1 would begin with a German advance from the region south of Oryol, eastward to the Don River where it approached Voronezh. Attacking from the areas of Kursk and Belgorod, two larger pincers of panzers and motorized forces, especially the northern group led by 4th Panzer Army, would advance to establish a strong left or northern defensive flank from Oryol to Voronezh, and in the process destroy the Soviet forces of the Voronezh front. During Blau II, the mechanized forces that had reached the Don would turn southward along the river's right bank to link up near Milarovo with 6th Army, advancing eastward from Kharkov, thereby creating another encirclement. As the panzers moved southward, Axis forces were to build strong defensive works along the Don to secure the operation's left flank. From Milarovo, Blau III called for a much deeper advance eastward, again paralleling the southern bank of the Don River and then crossing the Don at the point where it was closest to the Volga, in the Stalingrad region. There, the southeasterly advance would link up with yet another advance coming from Taganrog, near the Sea of Azov, which would also seize the Don River bridges at the key communications center of Rostov, the obvious starting point for further advances to the Caucasus. In light of the later course of the campaign, it is ironic that the original plan paid scant attention to the city of Stalingrad. The third attack, Blau III, in this scheme of operations will be so conducted that formations thrusting down the Don can link up in the Stalingrad area with forces advancing from the Taganrog-Artomovsk area. Every effort will be made to reach Stalingrad itself, or at least to bring the city under fire from heavy artillery, so that it may no longer be of any use to the Soviets as an industrial or communications center. Clearly, the city that today is synonymous with the 1942 campaign was not part of the original German objective. Neutralizing it was considered desirable but not essential to the real objective in the Caucasus. Führer Directive No. 41 went on to specify supporting tasks for the Luftwaffe and the German Navy, and to insist on absolute secrecy in preparing for the offensive. To this end, the Germans had already launched an operation known as Kremlin, a deception designed to play on Soviet fears of a renewed German advance on Moscow. Blau 4, the subsequent advance into the Caucasus, was projected in the introduction to Directive No. 41, but not elaborated in detail. Still, German staff officers were well aware of the dictator's intentions. Once the Don and Volga river lines were secure, panzer and motorized troops would spearhead the attack southward, except in the high Caucasus mountains, where the German and Italian mountain troops would come into their own. A special 10,000-man organization, the Oil Brigade Caucasus, waited to move into the oil fields and restore production as quickly as possible. Meanwhile, the Axis satellite armies, reinforced by anti-tank batteries and backed by a few mobile German divisions, would protect the ever-lengthening left flank of the German advance. Such an advance would pose an operational and logistical challenge greater than that of any previous German offensive. The straight-line distance from the starting point at Kursk to the Chechen city of Grozny, center of the Soviet petroleum industry, was 760 kilometers. The various encirclements for the plan meant an overall distance of more than 1,000 kilometers. Thus, the total advance would be greater than that achieved in 1941, and it would be done over a combination of semi-desert and mountainous terrain. To control this daring penetration, Hitler and his generals foresaw the need to split Army Group South into two separate entities, Army Groups A and B, at some point in the campaign, because the German forces would be pursuing two divergent objectives. On April 14th, Hitler directed the OKH to prepare for this eventuality by creating an additional Army Group headquarters under Field Marshal List. Lacking the resources for two full-blooded offensives, Hitler had turned to the artificial expedient of splitting his force into two groups with diverging strategic objectives. This field expedient failed to recognize that Blau actually involved three strategic axes: defending the Voronezh flank, securing the Don-Volga River area near Stalingrad, and moving into the Caucasus. At most, the Germans had sufficient combat and logistics capacity to support one of these axes, but not all three. This divided objective proved particularly ominous because, once again, the Red Army was much more resilient than German intelligence had expected. As previously noted, the shortage of German troops meant that the poorly equipped Axis armies, acting as a full army group, would have to protect the Voronezh flank. The Soviet Strategic Debate. The Soviet leadership was well aware that the Germans were gathering strength for another offensive. Unfortunately, the Soviets failed to identify either the true objective of that offensive or an appropriate response to it. Mesmerized by the desperate battles of the previous winter, Stalin and his subordinates were convinced that the next German offensive would again make Moscow its primary objective, with a possible secondary offensive in the south. Soviet commanders and intelligence analysts calculated that 70 German divisions could strike from the center of the enemy front eastward toward Moscow. These same analysts and commanders tended to ignore the possibility that many of the same divisions could pivot and strike southeastward. The defense of Moscow therefore received first priority for weapons, units, and the construction of field fortifications. It is ironic that a group of dedicated Marxists, who supposedly believed that the basis of all power lay in controlling the means of production, focused on defending their political capital rather than the economic value of the southeastern region of the Soviet Union. Even as the guns fell silent in March, the Soviet senior leadership began planning for the next campaign. Stalin was convinced he had been within inches of victory during the winter battles. Like Hitler, he continued to hope for decisive success in the coming months. The Soviet dictator therefore wanted to launch a new general offensive as soon as his troops had regained some strength and the spring mud had dried out. His subordinates tried to dissuade him, and the resulting Soviet strategy was an almost incoherent compromise between offensive and defensive. The chief of the Soviet general staff at the time was Marshal of the Soviet Union, Boris Mikhailovich Shaposhnikov, a scholarly, courtly 60-year-old who was one of the last Tsarist officers still serving in the Red Army. In the spring of 1942, a combination of overwork and respiratory distress was slowly destroying Shaposhnikov's health. On May 10th, he retired to the less demanding position of head of the Higher Military Academy. Meanwhile, he labored to convince Stalin of the dangers of a premature Soviet advance. Shaposhnikov was convinced that the Germans would launch a new offensive as soon as the spring thaw ended. Just as in the previous year, therefore, any Soviet attack must wait until this threat had expended itself on the Red Army's defenses. Shaposhnikov's former operations chief and hand-picked successor, Alexander Mikhailovich Vasilevsky, supported his chief's arguments even at the risk of the dictator's displeasure. Vasilevsky had earned Stalin's trust in part because, as a key staff officer, he had remained in Moscow with the Vozhd leader during the city's 1941 defense, when most of the government evacuated. Vasilevsky had risen from colonel to colonel general in 4 years, becoming chief of the operations directorate and deputy chief of the general staff in August 1941. He helped plan most of the major Red Army operations in 1941-42, and at the same time served as a representative of the Stavka, a trusted troubleshooter sent out from the capital to supervise critical field operations. Although Vasilevsky failed to dissuade Stalin from his plan for new attacks in the spring, he became chief of the general staff in his own right in June 1942, and deputy commissar for defense in October. At age 45, Georgi Konstantinovich Zhukov was already Stalin's favorite general in the spring of 1942. Since his victory over the Japanese at Khalkhin Gol, Mongolia, in August 1939, he had experienced rapid promotion, becoming chief of the general staff in January 1941. By the fall, he was a member of the Stavka as well as the Red Army's most influential front commander, and Stalin dispatched him to each successive crisis along the front lines. Zhukov understood the wisdom behind Shaposhnikov's and Vasilevsky's cautious counsel in the second year of the war. However, Zhukov was a naturally pugnacious man who was not above currying favor with his master. In his own recollections, Zhukov claimed he had warned against the danger of dissipating Soviet strength in too many local offensives. Still, it was entirely in character for Zhukov to urge Stalin privately to undertake limited offensive actions within the context of an overall strategic defense. Even Zhukov admitted to advocating a limited offensive in the Rzhev-Vyazma region in the north, which he regarded as the starting point for a renewed advance on the capital. The outcome of this internal debate was disastrous for the Soviet military. In early March, Stalin's initial guidance for the next campaign called for an active strategic defense, but directed planning for 7 local offensives from the Kerch Peninsula in the south to Leningrad in the north. Stalin's field commanders responded to the dictator's obvious preference for offensive action. Although they must have known the limitations of their own units, they gave Stalin overly optimistic assessments of the proposed offensives. Nowhere was this truer than in the southwestern main direction, one of 3 regional superheadquarters established on July 10, 1941. Marshal of the Soviet Union, Semyon Konstantinovich Timoshenko, commanded this grouping, which included both the southwestern and southern fronts. Timoshenko's reputation had soared in 1940 when he defeated Finland in the Winter War after his predecessors had bungled the job. After this success, the marshal became Commissar of Defense, and once the war broke out, chief of the Stavka and commander of a number of crucial headquarters. As head of both the southwestern direction and its subordinate southwestern front during the winter of 1941-42, Timoshenko pushed the Germans back with offensives near Rostov and the Izium region. The result was a large salient that both Stalin and Timoshenko wished to use for a spoiling attack against the Germans. As noted earlier, the German planners correctly identified this salient as a weakness they needed to eliminate prior to the main Blau offensive. In response to Stalin's planning guidance, Timoshenko called a meeting of his principal subordinates, the military councils of both the southwestern direction and the southwestern front. Most such military councils consisted of 3 men: the commander, his political officer or commissar, and the chief of staff. In this instance, the commissar was N.S. Khrushchev, who had headed the Communist Party in the Ukraine before the war. In this instance, however, the chief of staff position was split between 2 men because of the dual direction front command. Lieutenant General I. Kha Bagramyan, a 45-year-old ethnic Armenian, was both chief of staff of the southwestern direction and operations chief in the southwestern front. The chief of staff of that front was Lieutenant General P. I. Bodin. Whether because of professional belief or political expedience, these 3 men all agreed with Timoshenko's proposal for an offensive in the Kharkov-Izium region. On March 20th, Bagramyan presented his plan for this operation to a larger group of Timoshenko's subordinates. Khrushchev reportedly emphasized that Stalin himself had ordered the plan and stated that it was guaranteed to succeed. Not surprisingly, the assembled commanders acquiesced to the plan. The most charitable explanation is that these officers believed the Kharkov offensive to be part of a larger Stavka plan about which, in keeping with the Soviet mania for secrecy, they had not been informed. The March 20th meeting resulted in a series of highly optimistic reports from the southwestern direction to the Stavka. On March 22nd, for example, Timoshenko, Khrushchev, and Bagramyan forwarded their overall assessment for the spring-summer period. This report assumed falsely that the desperate conditions of midwinter, when German units had become dispersed and fragmented, still existed. At this stage of the war, Soviet military intelligence assessments were often inaccurate about German order of battle and capabilities, let alone future intentions. While noting that 3,500 German tank crewmen were assembled at Poltava to receive new vehicles, Timoshenko insisted there was no sign of reinforcement at the front. The March 22nd report therefore contended that, to forestall the anticipated German attack on Moscow, the southwestern direction should launch a series of minor attacks that, after the spring thaw ended, would lead to a major counteroffensive, pushing some 240 kilometers westward to the middle Dnieper River. In retrospect, the poor state of readiness of the Soviet units, other than the fledgling armored units, makes this optimistic assessment even more astonishing. In the same report, Timoshenko indicated that his divisions averaged only 51.2% of authorized rifles and less than 24% of machine guns. Such recommendations only encouraged the Soviet dictator's aggressive tendencies. Summoned to Moscow, the three leaders of the southwestern direction presented their plan to Stalin and Shaposhnikov on March 27th. At this stage, however, the Soviet preoccupation with defending their capital intervened. Although Stalin wanted an offensive against Kharkov, he was unwilling to weaken Moscow's defenses by providing the extensive reinforcements Timoshenko requested to implement his proposal. Instead, the military council of the southwestern direction went through several iterations of its plan, each more modest than the last. Until the council members finally satisfied their chief by requiring only modest reinforcements. At the same time, the other sectors of the Soviet defense prepared for lesser offensives. On April 9th, the Stavka directed the Leningrad and Volkov fronts, on either side of Lake Ladoga, to prepare an attack to rescue 2nd Shock Army, which had been encircled south of Leningrad since January. On April 20th, Moscow instructed the Bryansk Front, just north of Timoshenko's proposed Kharkov offensive, to plan a supporting attack along the Kursk-Lugov axis. The next day, another order required the Crimean Front to break out of the Kerch Peninsula and relieve the besieged port of Sevastopol. On April 22nd, the Northwestern Front received instructions to make another attempt to reduce the 2nd Corps of German 16th Army, encircled near Demyansk. Vasilevsky traveled in person to supervise these preparations. In the far north, the Karelian Front planned to push Finnish forces back to the 1940 border. The overall concept was that all these operations would occur in late April and early May 1942, preventing the Germans from shifting reserves from one sector to another. However, Kharkov remained the crown jewel of this spoiling counteroffensive plan. As the professional soldiers of the Stavka had feared, these limited offensives merely dissipated resources that would have been better employed to stop the renewed German onslaught. The Kharkov Plan. On April 10, 1942, Timoshenko issued the scaled-back but still ambitious plan for the Kharkov offensive. Even after it was amended on the 28th, it remained complex and daring. He intended to encircle and destroy the German 6th Army in the Kharkov region by enveloping it with two pincers. Northeast of Kharkov, the southwestern front's 21st, 28th, and 38th armies would advance out of the Staryi Saltov bridgehead on the western bank of the northern Donets River. Then 3rd Guards Cavalry Corps, reinforced by a tank brigade, would exploit southwestward to link up with the other pincer. This second attack, 110 kilometers to the south, was composed of the Southwestern Front's 6th Army, plus an ad hoc army-sized formation called Group Bobkin, led by the deputy commander of the Southwestern Front's cavalry, Major General L.V. Bobkin. Supported by two of the new tank corps, this formation would advance out of the Barvenkovo bridgehead over the northern Donets, pushing first west and then north toward Kharkov. This thrust was focused on the poorly equipped Hungarian 108th Division. The Soviets deployed much of their new materiel to penetrate the Axis defenses, presaging later heavy concentrations in the breakthrough sectors. The main effort in the north, Lieutenant General D.I. Ryabyshev's 28th Army, allocated 59.2 guns and mortars and 12 infantry support tanks per kilometer of front. Given Stalin's reluctance to reinforce Timoshenko, however, these concentrations could be achieved only by allocating almost all available forces to the field armies involved, with very little held in reserve. Timoshenko had only two rifle divisions, the 3-Division 2nd Cavalry Corps, and three separate tank battalions under his direct control, a force far too small to respond to unexpected situations. In making these plans, Timoshenko and his subordinates seriously underestimated their opponents. Soviet intelligence reported that General Paulus's 6th Army consisted of only 12 understrength infantry divisions and the equally threadbare 23rd Panzer Division. While this may have been accurate in March, by May Paulus had 15 much stronger infantry or security divisions, with another one en route from France, plus the 3rd and 23rd Panzer Divisions and two smaller ad hoc battle groups. Moreover, the Soviet planners largely ignored 1st Panzer and 17th Armies, which were yoked together under Kleist's command, located south of Barvenkovo. Given the mistaken belief that the Germans intended to concentrate on Moscow, they perhaps assumed that these units were low priority. In reality, Kleist commanded 26 divisions and 15 smaller combat groups. His strongest striking force was 3rd Motorized Corps, including 13th, 14th, and 16th Panzer and 60th Motorized Divisions, as well as the well-equipped SS Motorized Divisions Leibstandart Adolf Hitler and Viking. These units fell outside the Soviet operations area, but they were perfectly capable of attacking northward into Timoshenko's flank. Every kilometer the Soviets advanced westward only increased this vulnerability. The Red Army was about to thrust its head, eyes closed, into the lion's mouth. Overall, the southwestern direction intended to employ an impressive force of 765,300 men and 923 tanks against the 392 German tanks available for this battle. In short, both the German and Soviet plans for 1942 were exercises in wishful thinking. The Germans lacked both the combat power and the logistical reach to achieve their ambitious goal along the Volga and in the Caucasus. The Soviets had sufficient resources to halt and counterattack the proposed German offensives, but still had much to learn about maneuvering and supplying their field forces effectively. This residual German advantage in command, control, and planning declined as 1942 wore on. But it was conspicuously evident in May, June, and July, when the invaders achieved one last string of lopsided tactical victories. Chapter 3. Preliminary Battles, April to June 1942. Before the main effort in the summer of 1942, both the Wehrmacht and the Red Army conducted operations intended to create favorable conditions for the pursuit of their strategic aims. As noted in Chapter 2, the Germans wanted to jockey into the most favorable position to launch Operation Blau, whereas Stalin had authorized a series of spoiling offensives intended to weaken the looming German offensive. Neither side was ready to attack on schedule, and both dictators had to approve delays of their projected start dates. The Germans got in the first punch in the Crimea. Operation Bustard Hunt, the Battle for Kerch. General von Manstein, commander of 11th Army, knew he had to eliminate the Red Army's 44th, 47th, and 51st Armies from the Kerch Peninsula before he turned to the main prize, the fortress of Sevastopol. General Kozlov, commander of the Crimean Front, had crammed 259,622 men, 347 tanks, 3,577 guns and mortars, and 400 aircraft into an area that measured only 18 kilometers across by 75 kilometers deep. In theory, this elongated peninsula would force the attacking Germans to penetrate four successive defensive lines before reaching the port of Kerch itself. Yet Kozlov's forces, including 23 rifle and 2 cavalry divisions, 6 separate rifle and 4 tank brigades, 17 artillery regiments, and numerous smaller units, were densely packed in preparation for their own attack. They had little room to maneuver to defend themselves. Moreover, all Kozlov's supplies had to cross the Sea of Azov, interdicted by German air and light naval units. Kerch's importance was self-evident, but the Soviets mishandled the situation. Under repeated urging from the Stavka, Kozlov began in mid-January to submit plans for an offensive to relieve the separate coastal army inside Sevastopol. The first of these offensives failed in late January after negligible gains, prompting an impatient Stalin to intervene directly. At the end of the month, Moscow sent not one but 2 representatives of the Stavka, with their usual broad authority, to supervise Kozlov's operations. In this case, Stalin's lingering distrust of generals caused him to send a political hatchet man rather than an experienced soldier. By 1942, Lev Zakharovich Meklis, chief of the Red Army's main political directorate and a deputy chief of the general staff, already had a daunting reputation for purging the officer corps. During the 1941 German advance, he had condemned several defeated commanders to die in front of impromptu firing squads. In the Crimea, Meklis openly bullied the men on the scene, disrupting working relationships by reshuffling senior officers. In particular, he replaced Kozlov's experienced chief of staff, Major General and future Marshal Fedor Ivanovich Tolbukhin, with the other visiting Stavka representative, Major General Pavel P. Vechny. The combination of a mediocre commander, Kozlov, a domineering commissar, Meklis, and an inexperienced staff proved disastrous. The resulting confusion, in conjunction with the crowded situation on the Kerch Peninsula, had disastrous effects on troop readiness and morale. With Meklis and Vechny interfering in every aspect of planning, 47th and 51st Armies attacked again on February 27th, only to bog down and then totally collapse in less than a week. Another series of assaults in mid-April also ended in abject failure. The Crimean Front suffered 226,370 casualties between February and April 1942, with nothing to show for them. To attack Kozlov's densely packed force, Manstein could spare only 2 army elements, General of Artillery Maximilian von Fretter-Picot's 30th Corps, and Lieutenant General Franz Mutten.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.